What's up? Merete here, and in this video, we're going to cover all the muscles of the neck. The muscles of the neck can be divided into 5 groups based on their anatomical location, and keep in mind that the classification of the neck muscles may vary depending on the source you're studying from, but all the muscles are the same. So first are the deep muscles of the neck. Those are the deepest close to the vertebrae. Then we have the lateral muscles of the neck. The other two groups are related with the hyoid bone. The suprahyoid are located above the hyoid bone, and the infrahyoid are located below the hyoid bone. And notice that both groups attach to the hyoid bone. Then we have the craniothoracal muscles, and they go from the cranium to the thorax. So these are the groups we're going to focus on in this video. We're going to cover the origin, insertion, and the function of these muscles. And we'll start with the deep muscles of the neck. So the deep muscles of the neck are the longus capitis, longus colli, rectus capitis anterior, and the rectus capitis lateralis. Let's now add the skeleton for the outline and start with the longus capitis. The longus capitis is this tiny muscle located in the anterior side of the vertebrae. So if you remove the mandible and the teeth and look at the muscles from this perspective, we'll be able to see it better. So the longus capitis originates from the transverse process of the vertebrae C3 to C6, and it inserts at the inferior surface of the basilar part of the occipital bone. Primarily, when both sides contract, they ventrally flexes the head, and when one side contracts, it turns the head to the side. Next, we have the longus colli, which is a large muscle you see here. Longus colli actually consists of 3 parts. One is the superior oblique part, which is up here. Then there's the vertical part, which is here in the middle. And then there's the inferior oblique part, which is here. So the superior oblique part of the longus colli originates from the transverse processes of the vertebrae C3 to C5, and it inserts at the anterior tubercle of atlas, as you see here. The vertical part originates from the body of C5 to T3, which are all of these, and it inserts at the body of C2 to C4, as you see here. The inferior oblique part originates from the body of T1 to T3, down here, and it inserts at the transverse processes of C5 to C6. And the function of this muscle is the same as the longus capitis. Bilateral contraction flexes the neck, unilateral contraction turns the cervical vertebral column to the side. Then we have the rectus capitis anterior. This is a tiny muscle located just underneath the skull. It originates from the lateral mass of atlas, which is C1, and it inserts at the basilar part of the occipital bone. So again, unilateral contraction causes lateral flexion of the head. Bilateral contraction causes ventral flexion of the head. Then we have the rectus capitis lateralis, which is also a tiny muscle. It originates from the transverse process of atlas, C1, and inserts at the lateral part of the occipital bone. And the function is primarily lateral flexion of the head. So that was all the deep muscles of the neck. Now, let's talk about the lateral muscles of the neck. And these are mostly the scalenus muscles. We have the scalenus anterior, medius, and posterior. And they primarily originate from the first and second rib. So let's go ahead and remove the clavicle to see them better. The scalenus anterior is highlighted here. It originates from the transverse process of C3 to C6, as you see here, and it inserts at the scalenus tubercle on the first rib. Then the scalenus medius is located just posterior to the scalenus anterior, and this one originates from C1 to C7 or C2 to C7. It varies depending on the source you're studying from, but one thing they can all agree on is that it inserts on the surface of the first rib, behind the scalenus anterior. The scalenus posterior, however, is located posteriorly to the scalenus medius, and it originates from the transverse processes of the C5-C6 vertebrae and inserts at the surface of the second rib. Awesome. So those are the lateral muscles of the neck. Scalenus anterior, scalenus medius, and scalenus posterior. Now, between the scalenus anterior and the scalenus medius, you'll find a large artery passing between them called the subclavian artery, as it becomes the axillary artery when it passes them. So that was these. Now let's add the hyoid bone and cover the suprahyoid muscles, which are the muscles located above the hyoid bone. And these are the digasticus, stylohyoid, mylohyoid, and the ganuhyoid muscles. And again, they're all above the hyoid bone, so let's change the angle a little bit. Now, these muscles are primarily either going to attach to the inner surface of the mandible or the temporal bone, and from there, they will attach to a hyoid bone. And all of them have a common function, and that is to fixate the hyoid bone in place by pulling it from all sides. So the digastricus muscle is here, and it consists of two parts. There's the posterior belly, behind the hyoid bone, and an anterior belly, which is in front of the hyoid bone. Now, the posterior belly will originate from the mastoid notch of the temporal bone, and then it's going to insert at the tendon that inserts at the hyoid bone. The anterior belly will originate from the tendon that inserts at the hyoid bone, and then insert at the digastric fossa of the mandible. And the main function of this muscle is to pull the hyoid bone to keep it in place. Next, we have the stylohyoid muscle, which is here. It originates from the styloid process of the temporal bone and then inserts at the hyoid bone. And again, it pulls the hyoid bone to keep it in place. Next, we have the mylohyoid muscle, which is this one. It originates from the mylohyoid line of the mandible and inserts at the hyoid bone. Then we have the ganohyoid muscle, which is located back here, just on top of the mylohyoid muscle. It originates from the mental spine of the mandible and inserts at the hyoid bone. So that's the suprahyoid muscles. Next, let's cover the infrahyoid muscles. And these include the sternohyoid, sternothyroid, thyrohyoid, and omohyoid muscles. So again, remember that these are located underneath the hyoid bone. But some of these muscles have the word thyro in it, meaning that they will be attaching to the thyroid cartilage as well. So let's go ahead and add the larynx and the trachea. So first, we have the sternohyoid muscle, which is here. The sternohyoid muscle originates from the sternum and the clavicle, and it's going to insert at the hyoid bone. And this one is also going to pull on the hyoid bone to fixate it. Next, we have the sternothyroid muscle, which is located here, just behind the sternohyoid. This one will originate from the sternum and the clavicle as well, but insert at the thyroid cartilage, and it pulls the thyroid cartilage downwards. Then we have the thyrohyoid muscle, which is located here. It originates from the thyroid cartilage and then insert at the hyoid bone to fixate it as well. The last one is the omohyoid muscle. This is a long muscle that actually connects the scapula to the hyoid bone. And in the middle, there's a tendinous intersection that divides the omohyoid muscle into the superior belly and the inferior belly. So again, it's going to originate from the scapula and then go through the tendinous intersection, and it's going to insert at the hyoid bone to depress the hyoid bone. It might also assist with elevation of the scapula in some occasions. Primarily, the tendinous intersection is also attached to the carotid sheath, meaning it can also pull on the carotid sheath to dilate the internal jugular vein. So that was the infrahyoid muscles. Now, let's cover the craniothoracal muscles. And these include the sternocleidomastoideus, trapezius, and the platysma. Alright, let's do the sternocleidomastoideus first. These are large muscles located on the side of the neck here, and they originate from the sternum and the clavicle, and then they go up and insert at the mastoid process as well as the superior nuchal line. And it has several functions. Unilateral contraction will lateral flex the head and rotate the head to the opposite side. Bilateral contraction of the anterior fibers will ventrally flex the head, and bilateral contraction of the posterior fibers will dorsiflex the head. So that is the sternocleidomastoideus. Next we have the trapezius. Now the trapezius is also considered as a muscle of the back, so keep this in mind. It all depends on what source you're studying from. But all in all, it's also a craniothoracal muscle. Now the trapezius consists of three parts. There's the superior part, a middle part, and an inferior part. The superior part will originate from the superior nuchal line, the external occipital protuberance, and the nuchal ligament. It's then going to insert at the acromial end of the clavicle, as you see here, as well as the acromium of the scapula. Then we have the middle part, which originates from the spinous processes of the C7 to T3, or T4, and is going to insert at the spine of the scapula, as you see here, and the acromium. Then we have the inferior part, which originates from the spinous process of T4 to T12, and insert at the spine of the scapula as well. Okay, so what is the function of the trapezius? The inferior part will pull the shoulders downwards. Middle and superior fibers will pull the scapula towards the midline, as well as elevating the scapula. and they may also extend the head to the side as well in strong contraction, but primarily they're associated with movement of the scapula. So that is the trapezius. The last muscle is the platysma, and the platysma is located very superficially on the anterior region of the neck, and it covers all the neck muscles. It originates from the pectoral and the deltoid fascia down here, and it inserts at the base of the mandible, lower lip, and the skin around the mouth. And its function is primarily controlling the tension of the skin of the neck, and you'll often see it protruding as fibers on the neck when you tense it. It can also depress the angle of the mouth and the mandible. So that was all the muscles of the neck that I wanted to talk about. If you found this video helpful, please put a like, share, comment, whatever you find convenient to you. See you next time.